Last into the den are London-based jewellers Kirstie MacLaren and Katie Pell.
Can we stay in here forever?
And it seems like some pre-pitched jitters have set in.
We're a little bit nervous.
I'm terrified.
Look at my funny trousers. We're absolutely freaking out, but in all honesty, this is such an incredible opportunity.
I feel really overwhelmed. I'm going to cry.
OK.
The pair will need to find some fortitude if they're to give a glittering performance.
My biggest fear is obviously forgetting all of the key numbers, but hopefully I'll keep them in my mind.
Also in their minds are the dragons that the duo would most like to ensnare.
For us, Sarah is up there. She's queen of craft, and we think that she can take us big time. Wouldn't you agree?
I would agree. We've also got our eye on Debs. We like that she's got her heart in the right place with business.
Can't call her Debs.
Did I call her Debs?
Oh, Debs.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Hello, dragons. We're really excited to be here today. This is Katie, I'm Kirstie, we're both jewellers, and together we created the Workbench London. Today, we're asking for £50,000 of investment for a 10% share of our business. In front of you, you have one-of-a-kind ring-making kits, and the concept is simple. Designed and carved at home, cast and polished with us.
Our rings are made using recycled solid silver and they're hand-polished and cast in London. And we're really excited to find the right dragon to help us really grow the business and spread more sparkle. In front of you, you should have some kits and some rings.
Have you got your kits?
Somewhere!
Right, so we have given you a kit each. This is to display the range of products that we offer.
A sparkling mix of personality and passion from jewellers Kirstie MacLaren and Katie Pell.
Tuca, you have got the silver ring workbench box.
Who've come bearing gifts for all.
Tej, we've chosen, and this isn't a proposal, an 18-carat white gold wedding band.
They're asking for £50,000 in exchange for a 10% share of their design-it-yourself ring business.
Peter, you've got the signet ring kit. Sarah, you've got the gemstone kit that allows you to have a sapphire, ruby, or even a birthstone set into the ring that you design.
But will diamonds prove to be a dragon's best friend as the pair hone in on one of their favourite investors for the full lowdown on how the kits work?
Ooh, Deborah.
Oh, I'm
not gonna say wait for it, you've got a really good one. Deborah, you have got the diamond box. This allows you to have an ethically sourced diamond set in your ring that you design and make at home.
What do I do? Am I sketching something on here? I'm not trying to carve something in that.
So you have the online tutorials to show how you carve, carving away little tiny chips of the jeweller's wax.
And you can only go very slowly because it is a hard plastic when you start off, so you can't go wrong like, oh my God.
Right,
yeah.
Got it.
And so when you come to the end of your carving, you may end up with something like this. A diamond-shaped signet. That's what you send back to us.
So we prep the wax by making sure the wax is really beautiful and smooth and exactly how they want it. We're masters of understanding someone's wax ring design and what they really want it to be. And we can do little tweaks if they need it.
And then the casting company make a mould of the wax ring and offer a polishing service. And you can choose gold plating and engraving as well.
And that's gold plated?
Yeah. We used to get all of the gold plating done out of the workshop in Hatton Garden, and they just charge such a lot of money. So we bought a plating machine ourselves, and since then we've worked it out that that is a really good bit of extra that we get on there. And people seem to like it, yeah.
Kirstie and Katie confidently explain their concept to a smitten Deborah Meaden and reveal a business gem in the shape of investment in a cost-cutting plating machine. Tuca Suleiman now wants to see if the jeweller's books are as bling as their rings.
Let's just talk about numbers.
Yeah.
You've got a valuation of £500,000, mm-hmm. So let's get these big numbers. What are they, ladies?
OK, in 2018, we had a turnover of £129,000 with a net profit of £67,000.
Yep.
In 2019, we had a turnover of £137,000,
yep,
with a net profit of £70,000. And in 2020, we made £150,000, yep, with a net profit of £97,000.
Right.
Net profit or gross profit?
Net.
Net profit. What was your gross profit in that?
Yeah.
Well, I know that our profit margin was about, was 60. No, it's higher, it's now 72. Oh, God. Oh. We do have this information, but I know this isn't helpful now. It's okay. Yeah. So what was the numbers again? So it was
150 with 97.
Do you remember that middle number?
No.
Is it 40 something?
No, it's higher than that.
I can tell you the rough sort of margin is 72%, mm-hmm, on our best-selling kit.
So that must be your gross profit, 97,000.
Yeah, so you
then
can't possibly have made that net profit.
OK.
Yeah.
OK.
Because net profit is after you've taken all your expenses, your salaries, your overheads, your rent. Have you factored that into the 97,000 or no?
Yeah, that is the net profit, isn't it?
Yeah, that is the net profit.
Yeah.
The entrepreneur's uncertainty over the fundamentals of their finances leaves the dragon struggling to work out what profits the pair are producing. Kirstie and Katie's apparent poor preparation appears to have ruffled the feathers of Peter Jones.
This is really lovely and it comes out really well, but at the moment, I'm surprised you've even got here because your numbers are appalling.
Yeah,
and that's what really concerns
me. We've been working with an accountant, sorry.
No, but look, it's not okay, actually.
Yeah.
No,
you're
coming in for investment, and if you want money, you really worry me immediately because you're all over the place with your numbers. So we really need to get to the bottom of those numbers.
Yeah, okay.
So what's your value of your current stock?
So I think in the workshop it's about £5,000.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then 26 in the bank.
So you've got 31,000. You've got any other assets?
No.
Yes, you have. Can I answer? I've got a gold plating machine.
Yeah.
That's an asset.
Sorry.
Deborah, please come up for an help.
You're likeable for sure.
So how much did you pay for the machine?
It's about 1,500. And we've got polishing machines.
And how much were they?
£420.
And we've got two of those.
So that's another 800. So that's 33,500?
Yeah.
So what's happened to the 90,000 profit that you've made? What have you done with it?
Yes, VAT and tax and things. Could be like travel as well, because there's lots of travel involved.
Lots of travel? So you travel by private jet?
Yeah. No.
So you think that you've been making 90,000 this year and 70,000 last year, but you've only managed to accumulate £33,000 worth of net assets, then you're probably only making £5,000 or £10,000 a year.
Peter Jones's dissection of the company's balance sheet sheds no light on the jeweller's gross net conundrum. And it appears Tej Lalvani has heard enough.
The problem is, as an investor, where you're valuing your business at almost £500,000, at one end, it could be £97,000 profit, or you could be £10,000 profit. So, you should have done your homework to basically understand where your net profit is, because as an investor, to make a decision, I need to know how healthy your financials are. So, I think you've shot yourself in the foot. So, unfortunately, I can't invest. I'm out.
The entrepreneur's feeble grip on their company finances leads to the loss of their first dragon. And it seems that Tuka Suleiman is not far behind.
You've come in here, and I was very enthusiastic with the product. I was very enthusiastic with your energy. And all of a sudden, the whole business side just collapsed around you. So for that reason, I'm not going to invest, I'm out.
Okay, thank you very much.
Katie and Kirstie. Your presentation, high-spirited, clearly, it's great, but I think you've entered an environment and you need some real tough love because, it looks OK what you've done. But you've completely messed up. So, sadly, I'm out.
You have absolutely lost me on the business front. Listen, you could see I loved it, but this is so disappointing.
Yeah.
Because, like Tosh says, I don't know how you value a business if we have no idea.
Yeah.
Unless there's a gut feeling. And Sarah, to my right, is in the position to understand the gut feeling.
Hi.
So I'm going to listen to Sarah.
OK.
The duo's pitch hangs by a thread as Deborah Meaden defers to the craft space supremacy of Sarah Davies. Does she see the prospect as a potential goldmine, or will the jewellers be thrown on the scrap heap?
I'm trying to piece together the bits of what you've told us, and I'm assuming the figures you quoted us were gross profit, not net profit.
Okay.
So you had 137,000 sales last year, but you'll have had a lot of expenses in paying for things like your rental, your travel. So for all you've made 70 gross profit, you've probably made very little net profit.
Okay.
Can understand that.
Yeah.
Can't understand why you haven't made an awful lot more money this. Well, you might have done, because you've got to the end of the year and you've got 30 grand in the bank, haven't you?
Yeah.
OK, yeah. I think I've got a pretty good picture of the business. With all due respect, I think I've probably got a better picture of your business now than what you've got. But I think it's an exceptional product.
Thank you.
I think you're both very, very creative. I think you haven't got a business bone between you. And if I was to invest in this business today, I'm pretty sure I'd need to run your business for you.
OK.
So here is the offer I'd be prepared to make you. Right now, today, I would give you the 50,000 that you need. But in return, I would want 45% of the business, which gives me a majority share to get the business into some form of shape as a business. Once I get my money back, I will reduce to a 30% stake, which leaves you with 35% each. And I think that's fair based on the work I'm going to have to run this business for you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your offer.
Thank you.
Against the run of play, the entrepreneurs secure an offer from one of their desired dragons, Sarah Davies. Deborah Meaden, the pair's other preferred potential partner, cunningly waited for the den's craft queen to make her move. Will she be willing to undercut her counterpart?
So the bits you've got absolutely right today is you look like your product, you present really well, I get your energy, you've got ever so slightly deflated in the middle there. But I really like it. The issue I have is the time that you're going to need in terms of running the business. I'm afraid that's what's put me off. So you won't be getting an offer from me.
Okay.
I'm out.
Deborah Meaden declines the deal, making Sarah Davies' bid the only offer on the table.
All right. Do we need to chat?
Shall we chat?
Yeah.
Just because it's tradition.
Just because we're here.
And like, you can see the trousers, and we didn't know if we'd get this opportunity.
The dragon's demand for 45%, dropping down to 30% when she receives her money back, is a decision that deserves some in-depth discussion.
What do you think? Yes.
Yeah.
That was a bit quick.
Basically, we just went, yes, yes, yes. Just to make sure that we were definitely on the same page, which we normally are. Yes, please. Yes. I'm sorry.
Good decision.
Thank you.
Kirstie and Katie leave the den with the £50,000 they came for.
Wow.
And the dragon they desired, who can help to ensure the duo have all the hallmarks for success.
No, don't. Oh my God. Oh my God.
It's incredible.
We got Sarah.
I know.
We got Sarah. I know. And she is going to whip us into shape.
I am under no illusion that they are going to drive me round the bend. But honestly, that is going to be a big moneymaker.
To celebrate, something fizzy will definitely be involved. And maybe an Excel spreadsheet, because we've got some work to do.